Thank you, CSD President Professor Muchkund Dubey, CSD Vice President and my friend Mohanty, of course, Muchkund is also my friend, CSD Director Nityananji, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great privilege to give the Durgabhai Deshmukh Award lecture. The director has already talked about the capabilities of the Deshmukhs, Chintamani and Durgabhai. They were great institution builders, and I'm honored to give this lecture. I must at the beginning also express my sorrow at the passing away of my friend and comrade in many events, the late Ajmal Haq. His untimely death has been a big blow, and we are indeed very sorry for that. Now, I have a text which runs into 14 closely typed pages, and I just don't, I'm just not given the kind of time to cover that. So I will speak in a telegraphic style. I will make 15 points in 2 minutes each. And those of you who are interested in detail, I'm sure the CSD secretariat will be able to give you my written text. And you can correspond on it in terms of detail with me at my email ID, yalag@gmail.com. I think the choice that we are facing is, shall we force the pace of agricultural reform, or shall we phase it? In a sense, we are at a policy crossroads. My impression is that it's much better to consult, particularly since the Reform Act was, as you know, passed on a single day. And this is a continental country. And one size fits all is really not something which you can try and force through. But there are some people in government who try to force through the pace. And I think that normally leads to a reaction which in fact delays us more. Another reason why we shouldn't force the pace in this year is that the reform under the Act is basically trade-oriented. Now, trade and transport are two sides of the same coin, as the great Gottfried Haberler showed to us, or any good book like that, any good book on international trade tells us. And if you have a COVID pandemic and transport is strictly monitored and is closed down at short notice, I'm not blaming the local authorities. The collector, if he has to save lives, will always save the train, stop the train. But it's better for us to face the Reform Act, partly because the transport arteries are closed down because the need to save lives is far more than trade. The other argument, of course, is that, obviously there's a lot of conflict which is going on, is that the Northwest agriculture everywhere should be specializing and diversifying, but the Northwest concentrates only on grain. Now, that's a very silly argument. When you say that you are planning for a diversified agriculture, you mean diversification given the soil, the land, the climate of every area. And the Northwest, Punjab, Haryana, and West UP, good alluvial soil, plenty of irrigation, groundwater, well, they're facing some problems, but not like in Gujarat or Maharashtra where we sort of temple bells start ringing if we find water at 300 feet. Even today, in Punjab, Haryana, and Western UP, you say that you are going deep down if you have to go down to 100 feet. So in that kind of agriculture, we should let them go for the highest yielding weeds at the highest yielding paddy. Yes, there are parts of Punjab, particularly the southern region, and parts of Haryana which are not covered by the Indira Gandhi canal, where you could have oil seeds and pulses. But the basic strategy of grain in this area, which is creating a lot of problems, is I think wise. And to argue for diversification and to say that one is against that is not kosher as far as I'm concerned. It's in a way saying that areas like Gujarat and Maharashtra should not concentrate on oil seeds and pulses and diversify into grain. That will be equally silly. The other argument that is being made is that we must push through private trade and RCAs. And the argument is given that RCAs are important in northwestern India, in Punjab, in Haryana, in Western UP. So we must push them through everywhere. Now, it has to be appreciated that the RCA in the northwest, in Punjab, Haryana, and Western UP, is basically only an agent of the FCI. He procures the grain for the FCI. And Dr. Manmohan Singh at one stage brought him in because he felt that that way the handling charges of the RTAs would be less. But they are not like the RTAs in Rajasthan, or in Madhya Pradesh, or in Gujarat and Maharashtra, where there is a real conflict between the Jat or the Patel farmer and the RTA traders. And so I think it is wrong to argue that RTAs are involved in private trade in the Northwest. It is correct that they do get into So RTAs do get into private trade in a way such that the conflict between the Lala and the Jat is there in the rest of the country. Now, but in the rest of the country, the MSP is not as important as it is in the Northwest. In fact, the MSP in a place like Gujarat or in Maharashtra or even in parts of Madhya Pradesh is like a concept that economists have of ghost money. Ghost money was something which was developed by an Italian economist called Carlo Cipolla. And Cipolla argued that even when a certain unit of certain money becomes not the unit of exchange, but it can remain in people's minds as the unit of account. It's like we still talk about annas, and although there are really no annas, we work with rupiah and naya paisa. And once upon a time, there used to be kodis. And kodis are... So in a way, MSP is important in the Northwest of Bihar. And outside the Northwest, in fact, it is not important. And it's important to recognize that and to think of strengthening the markets, a kind of reform which is there in the act that was passed in Parliament. Last year, agriculture was good. In a year which, to use an expression which Queen Elizabeth had used, was an annus horribilis. This year, I'm not sure because already there's been a rainfall failure. But I've not covered that because we get to know that only now. But I think to push the FRBM to argue that we shouldn't support agriculture, I agree with the chairman of the Finance Commission that this is not quite the time to be pressing the FRBM, and we should support agriculture the way we have pointed it out, and the FRBM can wait. MSP, you know, once upon a time there used to be an MSP for each crop done separately. And I said, no, there's no point in doing that, because MSP has to be a part of a system of relative prices. So in 1982, when I was chairman BI, chairman APC, I started the first report where price relatives became the object of policy rather than supporting each crop separate. And in fact, the Secretary of Agriculture, who was a very senior IAS officer, and later on became Chief Secretary in West Bengal, said, Mr. Chairman, we want every report to be separate. So I told him that there is for each crop a separate chapter, but you have to look at the whole question of price relative, which is the first chapter of the, in those days it was called APC, now CATP report. So he insisted that he would not like this and he would want that. And I just sort of tell him, my commission is an autonomous commission and the government has no right to insist. And I think to his dismay, he found that out. So he had to go on with that. But the point more is that the MSP works, does work in the Northwest. For the rest of the country, it is more a kind of flag post which the farmer uses, because he says, I want a price better than this. And, you know, they're very civilized about this. They came into Maharashtra last year, searched all the way from Nashik, and then they were told that the kids are going to school on that day in Bombay. So they said, we'll wait outside. So this is happening all over the country. Lalji Desai did it in Gujarat. He brought out 1,000 tractors, and Sanat Mehta and me went with him. And we let them negotiate with the government. Now, this has become a kind of practice that when the farmer feels he is mistreated, they bring out the tractors and they force the government to listen to them. And I think it would be, government would be well advised to give them a hearing rather than forcing them out into the situation where they are in conflict with the authorities. I think it is true that the Essentials Commodity Act should be dumped, and the legislation provides for that. Unfortunately, Dubey Saab, our foreign service mein the, but the IAS wala's, they still don't go along that way. And when need be, they bring in the Essentials Commodity Act again. We have seen that happen during the last 2 weeks. I think once this is an act, it should most certainly not be allowed. And as soon as the milk train starts going from Nashik to Bombay and from Mehsana to Navsari, in any case, it's a trade-dominated agriculture and not an essentials commodity dominated agriculture that we should pursue. Does trade help everybody? In theory, yes. I mean, my teacher was a big Kravis. But if you have imperfect markets, Then I think the concept that unilateral trade liberalization is advocated is something I would agree with Muthukumar Dubey. It's not that something that we should support. Multilateral trade, yes, but then multilateral trade needs to be negotiated. Unilateral trade liberalization. There are some of my economist friends are very great supporters of that. I tend to be a little skeptical of that, and I don't think there's anything in theory which says that trade will help if the multilateral institutions are not functioning, that unilateral trade will help. There was another argument that has been raised, which I've dealt with in my Durgabai Deshmukh lecture, which is the whole concept of cost. Now, I'd written a report in which I'd argued that rental on land should be allowed for the fixation of MSPs. And some very outstanding economists working in the government made the very valid argument from Ricardo, Rajiv Kumar, Vivek Roy, that rental on land is a Ricardian rent, and therefore it is unearned, so it should not be allowed. Now, my argument there is that they are absolutely right. Rental on land is a Ricardian concept. It is an unearned income. But the point is that you allow people to have unearned income on anything else. You allow them to have state rents on mining leases that you give. You allow them to make scarcity rents on imports for which you facilitate for them. So if you are doing that for the corporate sector, your argument for not giving the rental to the farmer is not very valid. And I think the Swaminathan Commission tended to agree with me, not tended to, in fact, did agree with that argument. So I don't think that argument should be there. Now, my next argument, of course, is on the whole question of the WTO and the special and differential treatment argument. I mean, I don't want to spend too much of time on that in a lecture which is presided over by Muthukumar Dubey, who is a bit of a legend in that area. But the BCR argument, the dirty tariffication argument, I think these are all very valid arguments for which to practice. And the Indian argument that the livelihood argument should be allowed to us, the special differential treatment should be there for that, has much to be said for it. We argued it all through. And the G77, with support from people like Muthukumar Dubey, backed us up. Murasali Maran, in fact, died defending that argument. And Suresh Prabhu followed it through up till Argentina, the argument in Argentina. But then all of a sudden, the government of India gave it up. And they have now said that the other issues can also be discussed. Now, this, in my mind, is not very strong here. Guys. This has most certainly led to a lot of arguments against it. There are many countries in the third world which feel let down with this. And I think us giving up on this, we have given up a leadership role on both the special and differentiated. And I think Malla's, my teacher Malla's argument of dirty tariffication, the Asia problem, these are all well known. I've dealt with them in my teacher. I will not get into detail. I think this argument that if you are giving consumer price support, and you are subsidizing, and that there is a trade-off between the two. This is a false argument. You remember Ashok Gulati, together with, in fact, when Ashok was doing his PhD, I was in the BICP, so he came and met me, and we helped him in working out discriminatory tariff policy outcomes and discrimination. And he made the argument that India taxes agriculture. And so the World Bank said, yes, they tax agriculture and they support industry. But later on, they wanted us to they said that we should not support agriculture with the WTO. So Gulati also changed his argument. And he said that the discrimination against agriculture is not what it was. This is in a not very well-known piece, but it is printed by Gulati and Malak and others. And it really shows how trade arguments can be used for the need that is there of the time being rather than any permanence to them. There has been an argument that India should not do stockholding in grains because in purchasing power parity terms, you are doing very well. I find that very strange. I was told when I went to the World Bank in the mid-70s in a seminar that the purchasing power parity line really comes from the Planning Commission's poverty line, the dollar a day. Well, that might have been true at that stage, but then, you know, the way they do the price increases and so on, I jokingly said in a seminar in the 80s in Washington that according to your latest dollar-denominated purchasing power parity line, I am poor, although I am a very highly paid professor in my whole life. And I think the question really is that you should be looking at the relative prices which are important in agricultural trade and not the price of David motorcycles going into building up your purchasing power parity for subsidizing public stockholding and consumers. I had a somewhat longish trade argument, but with Mukund Dubey there, I will stay out of it. The argument that we don't have credible agriculture is incorrect. I think agroclimatic planning is basically, which we started in the later part of the 70s, in the early part of the 80s, is basically an argument for trade. It says that not every region should grow grains. Every region and every country should grow what they can specialize in, and for the rest, they should trade. But that doesn't mean that we will take the trading regime if it is unfair as given. We can be both in favor of trade and argue for multilateral trade reform. And I don't think this is at all inconsistent with each other, as some people bring it out to be. The fiscal argument is there, that how much can you support, but it's at the margin. And the more important thing is that this is the way you will go on the lines of sustainability. Now, that's very important. Because the student is looking at me that I'm exceeding my time. But, in this pandemic year, there's a Harvard economist of Romanian origin. His name is Nicolas Georgescu Rojan. He's one of my favorite economists. And he's built up something called the law of entropy. And the law of entropy basically says that if you have a fixed quantity of resources and you overconsume them, then the situation will explode. It's something like what in the Hindu mythology we call pralaya, that is, the world will come to an end. So we have to be careful when we use resources. Sustainability is not just an argument for agriculture and farmers. It's an argument to avoid pandemics also. And pandemics are more important than what we think they are. In the beginning of the century, the Secretary General of the United Nations had asked some of us to write a paper each on what we think are the big threats of the century. And I won't talk about my paper, but one of my colleagues, Anna Marie Slaughter, who was the Dean of the Woodrow Wilson School in Princeton, and she argued that nuclear war will probably not be possible in the 21st century because game theory tells us that everybody will know that if they want to destroy the other man, they'll get destroyed themselves. But she said that the dangers will come from viruses. And given the mindset that we all have, she said that the viruses will originate from Africa. Well, this time it originated from the bats in Wuhan. But the important issue is that agriculture should be sustained. And that means that everything we talked about, I did it very briefly in this talk and in a little more detail in the text that I have already submitted to CSD, that these issues are of some importance. I would recommend that we should take up the issues crop by crop, maybe crop sets, where relative prices are important, and look at what are the policies which are required in the next phase, and spell them out in some detail. Have consultations on them, as Ramesh Chand has argued in the implementation of the Farm Trade Act, and then adjust as you go along. So I would not recommend pushing through the farmers' bills without consultation, without a roadmap. I would recommend spelling out a framework, making it a base for discussion, going out into the field and having discussion with farmers' groups, with bankers and others, and then implementing it as you go along. It can be a very rewarding exercise. I've done it twice in my life. One was the poverty line. I didn't just develop a poverty line. An economist called T.L. Dutta has just written a book from the Oxford Press, and he tells me, he says that he wanted to join the Planning Commission, so he was asked to see me. And I grilled him for 3 hours, which is nonsense because I don't grill anybody. But I must have discussed with him. And then I told him that you have the skills now. Let's build a new poverty line. But after we developed a poverty line, I went all over the country and I discussed it with trade unions, with farmers groups, with chambers of farmers, with newspaper editors, so that there was a degree of understanding, not necessarily agreement, which is very important in a continent. Now that is what we need again. I did that again in agroclimatic planning. Groups all over India went there. These things give you many great benefits. I get always messages from Sarangi, who was a collector in Nashik, when I said we must get out of sugarcane into onions and grapes. And he said, sir, I will do it. And as Nashik, that area, went into wineries, He keeps on telling me, sir, I did it, and later on became chairman of Nabard. So I think we need to take agriculture, take relative crops, look ahead for the next phase, have discussion, and build up policies to implement, and so that our agriculture does well. It did well last year. It could have done better. Fortunate for monsoon bad this year. It needs support. I hope that will be forthcoming. So with those words, I will hand myself over to anything that we could do for the rest of the time that we have in this year's Gurkha lecture, for which I thank you, Professor Dubey, for inviting me to give it. I'm sorry I couldn't cover my text, but in the time that I have, I thought I'd only make a few brief points. Thank you. Jai Hind.